Hey everyone, today we talk about Kotlin, the programming language. We cover why you should use it and how it can help you as an engineer even write better code. I had two guests on, which are the only certified Kotlin trainers here in Holland, Paulien van Alst, software engineer at OpenValue, and Urs Peter, my direct colleague, and you might remember him from episode one. Don't forget to like and subscribe on YouTube and follow us on your favorite podcast platform. Enjoy!
Successful people in IT. From your sponsors, Zebia, creating digital leaders. Here's your host, Patrick Akil.
Hey guys, how's it going? Urs, Paulien, welcome. How's it going, Paulien?
I'm fine. I'm very excited to be a guest at this podcast. It's the first time for me. So
awesome. Happy to have you. And Urs, returning guest?
Definitely. Yeah.
Our setup is a bit different from episode one. So
you made quite some progress. So it's
exactly
impressive to see what happened in the meantime. But definitely I'm glad to be back.
Cool, man. Happy to have you both. So I invited you on to talk about Kotlin as kind of a new programming language, new kid on the block, even though it's years old. programming languages move like snails. So it's fairly new still. But first of all, Paulien, I'll start with you. Why are you passionate about Kotlin as a programming language?
Well, I really like the fact that it takes away some boilerplate code that you're used to when you're programming in Java or C#, for instance.
Yeah.
So somehow I really like to express myself using all those language features that Kotlin has, such as a data class or extension methods, for instance, where you can finally define behavior on collection level, for instance.
Yeah.
Which I find really elegant, although yeah, we can discuss some powerful thingies there, but I really like that language feature. I also really like the community vibe that surrounds Kotlin, where the community gives really some input to how Kotlin can evolve. And as Kotlin is evolving and releasing very often, the community is heard. So I really like that as well. And the ecosystem is growing now at the Kotlin side as well.
Yeah.
So it has less of a industry vibe that Java has, which is a slow vibe somehow, which is completely understandable.
Yeah.
But somehow, that what gets me attracted to Kotlin.
Yeah. Really just the vibe and the way they're handling it.
Yeah, exactly. It's a bit more modern, I could say, compared to Java, and you feel really the innovation takes place there.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah.
Urs, what about you?
Yeah. Actually, I think many people that move to Kotlin, also when you look at the statistics, they've done Java.
Yeah.
I've also done Java, but then I did Scala, which was a bit the other end of Java, way overly complex, even so very elegant, kind of prose and code. And so technology I tried to apply at different assignments, but it was or Java, which is old-fashioned, or Scala, which is way over the top.
Yeah.
And then I tried out Kotlin, and literally within 4 hours, I absorbed it, and I was enthusiastic about this language because it had really the best of both worlds. It's very pragmatic. It really thinks for the developer. It's also made for developers, not very academic or, as you nicely mentioned it, the industry kind of language, a lot of proposals to change things. It's really coming from people using it, or at least their input is heard. Which allows you not only to express yourself way better, but also write software that is considerably more robust, less bugs, more concise, more readable, more maintainable, and so on.
Yeah.
And to such a degree that it really makes a tremendous difference. Sometimes you might think, okay, programming language, does it make a difference? It depends. I mean, with every language, you can write great software depending on the engineer, right? But with Kotlin, you get so much more benefits right away with quite a low hurdle to learn it, that for me this was such an eye opener that I just fell in love with it. And since then, actually, I'm only coding in Kotlin.
Love at first sight, basically.
Yes.
You said you kind of picked it up within a few hours, even just kind of exploring it. Do you think that's kind of representable for most people with kind of your background? So coming from Java development and also having a little bit of experience in a different language.
I To be honest, I don't think so, especially when you have a strong background in Scala. Kotlin is more a bit of a subset, but when you have a strong background in Java, Kotlin introduces concepts that are not that familiar within the Java domain. Definitely functional programming practices, which are first class in Kotlin, are not that present in Java. Yeah. Also, for instance, working with immutable data structures, which are also kind of default in Kotlin, are not really present there. No. So from Java going to Kotlin, it's really a steeper learning curve, but it's definitely one you can way easier do than the curve from Java to Scala. I think that's kind of broadly accepted.
Yeah, so that gap you have to cross is a little bit less big if you're starting out with Java.
Yes.
I've seen or I've heard, I'm not very, very much an expert in that case, but that the features that Kotlin introduced are now also being used or introduced in Java as well.
Yeah.
If we kind of throw up the term Java versus Kotlin, why would you use Kotlin over kind of Java in that way? What do you think?
Yeah, I think Kotlin is kicking Java's butt, right?
Oh, really?
Because there are some language features that Java didn't want to introduce, or at least people in the lead of maintaining Java. But those language features being so popular in Kotlin are being introduced in Java, but sometimes entirely introduced. Sometimes there are some midway implementation, such as the var keyword.
Yeah.
Kotlin knows the var keyword for mutable variables, where there is also the val keyword for immutability. The val keyword doesn't exist in Java. Mm. Why, to come back at your question, why choose Kotlin over Java? There are plenty of reasons. We chose to use Kotlin in a project because we didn't want to use Lombok. It's another dependency. We wanted to have data classes. We wanted to challenge us to use immutable types. We want to get rid of nullable types. And we were working on this Java 8 project where we were really happy with all those with the streaming APIs.
Yeah.
Where we had those collections converted to a stream, doing a filter, a map reduce, and then maybe do something else, so there's long chains of collection manipulations, and there were a lot of bugs on those part of the business logic.
Yeah.
So we started to refactor that to using extension functions to describe it in a readable way, and then we proposed that chain of readable methods to the product owner. He said, no, this should be the other way around, you know?
Yeah.
So to be able to share our code with our product owner, that was a very big improvement that Kotlin gave to the project. So if you're working on a project where you find yourself in those kind of
situation
where you want to involve your product owner, because Kotlin can be a nice improvement, but it's not the holy grail, right?
Yeah.
So Kotlin, if you have a messy code base, Kotlin won't clean it up for you. So you need to understand those idioms of Kotlin to introduce them to your Java project. For me, that was a big eye-opener.
Yeah.
On other projects, we need to use coroutines. There's no such an equivalent yet in Java.
Yeah.
If you're using Spring, which is a common framework in the Java world, Spring is also implementing coroutines as well. So if you want to have reactive applications, then Kotlin together with Spring Flux can be a very good argument to use Kotlin as well, and to leave Java aside, actually. So there are very many reasons to go over to Kotlin.
Yeah. If you already have a Java product or project even, how fast can you start with a small experiment to kind of learn from? Because you said we already had something.
Yeah.
And then you introduced it in kind of a small matter.
Yeah.
And you gained a lot of benefit from it.
Yeah. We did it in several steps. We actually refactored first our API classes, our plain Java objects, to Kotlin data classes.
Okay.
So that was the first step, where we just reduced all those classes with getters and setters and implementations of equal methods to simple Kotlin data classes. That was the first win.
Yeah.
And I guess you got about 80% code reduction, or as I call it,
maybe 90%.
Clarity. Yeah, 80% clarity. More clarity in your domain.
Yeah, in our domain. Yes. And the Git diffs that we showed to our product owner, because we had to convince him to get some time to get over to Kotlin.
Yeah.
He was, wow, you only need to write that piece of code
exactly.
Do the same thing. Yeah. So yeah, that was the first win.
Yeah. I think within software projects, right, there's actual complexity, like mm-hmm. business logic, mm-hmm. And weight of code is also a means to kind of introduce complexity, right? Yeah. If you need to read a lot of code to get through what it's actually doing, that is inherent complexity.
Exactly. Right? And the more the code you write, the more bugs can occur. You know, there are also bugs sometimes on setters or even on getters. So if you can abstract it away and make sure that it's nobody can introduce some errors there,
exactly.
It's pretty good.
It keeps it lean and mean, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Mm. Cool. Yeah. Urs, what are your thoughts on kind of the Java versus Kotlin?
Yeah, fully agree with what you said. I even would take it a bit further. There's actually there are only reasons against Java nowadays because Kotlin did such a balanced act of what you really need in your code base.
Yeah.
That you actually only gain benefits when you move over to Kotlin compared to Java. There's really not a single feature that you think, okay, if I had it in Java, then life would be such or such. And so there are, of course, two reasons. One reason is developer reasons, which, of course, like to write concise code, want to have cool features that allow them, for instance, working with immutable structures, nullability, have extendable ways of extending your domain with extension methods, and so on and so on. And then you also have the business part of it, right? The product owner also needs to kind of understand what kind of investment he does to get the move to Kotlin justified.
Yeah.
And what you see there is that across many projects, you get about 40% of code reduction. Mm. And personally, I don't like the word code reduction because you can write these one-liners, nobody understands, and you also have code reduction. But it's actually more about code clarity. So what you just mentioned with the domain, for instance, it captures simply the essence of what is relevant. And the rest is just boilerplate that blurs what you're actually trying to represent in your software.
Yeah.
So by getting rid of this, you get clearer code, and clear code is better to maintain. Also contains, of course, less bugs because, for instance, if you forget to implement an equals method, then your code might just behave on this certain particular part a bit different. Whereas, for instance, in Kotlin, you have this data class that generating for you and so on.
Yeah.
So this 40% is a big issue. Reduction in increasing clarity. And the other one is actually that you write way more robust software with the still quite simple addition of this nullability, which also across a project we've seen, you got about 25% less bugs simply because you have a language contract. So you don't have a better developer, which just knows how to program better. No, you just have a language construct that makes a distinction very clear what is nullable, what not. You give him some tools to deal with nullable values, nice APIs and so on, and you get 25% less bugs. And that's, I think, is a very strong business case from the business side. And then we haven't really talked about developer satisfaction, but I think these two numbers should really be very a strong indication that you should take Kotlin very serious and try it out and help to evaluate it, whether this can also for you make the difference.
Yeah.
The big side note there would be that people understand the idioms of Kotlin. Deal with nullability in Kotlin is something you're not used to deal with Java. And I've seen also terrible Kotlin code examples because people don't know how to deal with it.
Yeah. And I think that's a very interesting subject in terms of training people, get them on board. We should discuss it, but I fully agree with you because if you let people write Java-ish code in Kotlin, the mess can maybe not get worse, but definitely not better, or maybe even worse because you have to rewrite it anyway.
It gets worse because you're writing Java equivalent code in Kotlin, which is just, you're crossing two worlds that shouldn't be crossed. Yeah. You can copy Java code in IntelliJ in your editor and then paste it in a Kotlin file and then IntelliJ will do the work for you, but it won't do the work for you.
No, definitely not.
Definitely not.
But it makes a beginning, right?
It makes not a beginning, and then you can refactor it. But if you omit the refactor part there, then you end up with a code base that's even bigger mess. So
that's right.
So it's very important that you understand what are the ideas behind Kotlin. What does Kotlin want you to do? If you understand that, then it gets very elegant.
Yeah. For sure. I really like that the tool kind of leverages what it knows about kind of past experience of even developers' experience, right?
Yeah.
And introduces concepts to help developers by default, right? That immutability is already something that is helping just inherently by being there, basically. Yeah. You have to use it, yes. But when you use it, your code bugs are reduced by means of it, basically. But let's start with a scenario that you already laid out in. You have a Java project. What's kind of the right way of taking that step and introducing Kotlin? Also the right way, so to make sure you're not just doing your Java developing in a Kotlin style or jacket.
Well, doing small steps. I would say that the team should challenge itself to introduce a language feature per language feature so that you get used to the language feature, right? So data classes are one example. It's maybe very small, but each learning curve doesn't need to take 3 months, right? But just try to understand that language feature. We also then did extension functions, but only extension functions. And then we were like, oh, it can also be too powerful. So just as a team, agree on when to use it and when not to use it. So we did it language feature per language feature. Then we introduced the DSL for testing. Very powerful. Not everyone understood it. Okay, let's just try to understand it all together. And just go language feature per language feature. So you can understand the idioms that you need to get used to when you're coming from the Java world.
Yeah, that makes sense. Step by step, like you would any other kind of experiment in that way.
Yeah, exactly. Like any other experiment that we do all the time as a Scrum or IT team. And try to learn from it and reset the rules on your code style, on your reviews, on whatever you need to set rules on. Because those will be different than with Java.
Was there any extra thoughts or any additions you want to make there?
It's a very interesting question. I think there is not one answer, right? No. It depends. So I've just also looked up the figures. Mm. For instance, 30% of the projects, existing project, Java project, Kotlin is introduced, whereas Kotlin is most used for new projects. Because when you have new projects, your journey will be different than when you have existing project introducing it. And I think a step-by-step approach is valuable there. What I have seen, and I see actually more often with clients, because I'm a trainer, I look like that, so maybe I'm biased, but I still think it is certain truth for a large population, is that it really helps when you have at least one knowledgeable person on the team who really knows these defaults, who knows how to apply them in the right way. And second, it really also helps to educate your developers in the sense that you give them with a course or some training on the job, at least the basics, just to explain a bit more about the paradigms behind it, not just why there's this keyword, but what it actually helps you to do and give them some justification, show them what happens if you don't do it and so on. So I think with about, that's my experience, about 2 days training and someone on the team who understands the code base going step by step, I think then you have the largest largest chance to make to make it a success quite easily. And if you don't, then it depends a bit on how developers grasp the concept and kind of intuitively apply it. If they do it completely wrong, for instance, we had this code base where they said, okay, let's try to get Lombok into Kotlin. This is what they tried to achieve. And of course, that's unnecessary because Kotlin has all these Lombok features in the language itself, so you don't need Lombok.
Yeah.
And so they spent quite some effort to put Lombok into Kotlin.
Exactly.
I think Pauline is having just a slight microphone issue. Let's see. I think Martijn is helping out in that way. It happens. Let's see. So from my perspective, I might even be able to guess the answer already. If you have a Java project, should you already start making those steps into rewriting stuff to Kotlin, or why should you do it or why should you not do it, basically? Is there anything against doing it?
If your team doesn't want it, then that's that's always a reason not to do it, or at least not start doing it.
Yeah.
Trying to convince them. If I think about it, I won't see any reasons. Or maybe if you're using a Java framework that's not Spring, or maybe something else that's not dealing well with Kotlin.
Yeah.
But also with that, I can't really think of a framework.
Exactly. I just want to ask which framework, because
I can't
generally.
So maybe internal frameworks, you know, because big companies tend to invent a lot of stuff themselves.
Yeah, okay. But that's right.
If I'm looking at the industry, a lot of Java frameworks are either are even adopting Kotlin. So I won't really see any reasons not to do it.
Yeah.
So only if the team doesn't understand it or doesn't want to understand it, that's the only reason I can see.
I've done also a bit research, and of course, with my personal experience, we also had this case where I had some legacy code bases, and there the question was, do you want to do it or not? And the point there is it's mostly an investment question. So does the PO want to invest just in Kotlin? And that's kind of really a hard sell. That's what my experience is.
Yeah.
And it really helps maybe if you just have this major refactoring of this new feature that is introduced where you also rewrite parts of code base in Kotlin. I think this could help.
Yeah.
But just a rewrite for the rewrite is kind of hard to achieve.
Yeah, hard to justify as well, basically.
Yeah.
Right, because the only thing you're probably going to need is time to experiment a bit and introduce concepts in your code base and see if you can learn from it and even benefit from it, right? That's the only way and the only reason you're doing this in the first place.
Yeah.
But because you take those small steps, I think that's also something you can pick up incrementally with the other work that you are already picking up.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And what's also, I think, very beneficial nowadays, because of microservice architectures, these code bases tend not to be huge monoliths, but rather small pieces of chunk. So to experiment with it or to rewrite a microservice, I think, is an ideal case just to get started with it. I don't know what your experiences are in that regard.
You can just refactor one microservice. It won't be that hard.
Yeah.
I usually introduce it by implementing a new microservice. So when you're starting from scratch, but especially if you're confident in your microservice, if test coverage is pretty high, why not? Yeah, because it's pretty well tested.
Yeah,
and will only improve it.
Yeah,
why not?
Yeah, and if you go from kind of a balance in code base where you still have Java code and Kotlin code, what happens to the developers that are used to the Kotlin code and all of a sudden have to go back to Java? What are some of the signals you get there?
I forget the terminal operator.
Exactly.
So and you hear a lot of frustration.
Exactly.
Really?
It's quite interesting because I had many times in my teams, not only once, but I call them very strongly attached to Java. Mm-hmm. Let's call it that way. Because they were very smart programmers. They could solve everything with Java. And for them, it was really kind of the question of why should I take all the effort in Kotlin because I get it done in Java. But after half a year, they're over to Kotlin and they're all the same. Nobody ever wants to go back to Java. Really, nobody I've met so far.
Yeah, this is even, I did a test for a new assignment, I think 2 weeks ago. And starting the test, they said, yeah, three assignments are in Kotlin. So I switched my mind. Okay, I'm going full Kotlin now. And then the third assignment was in Java. But I didn't notice it for because I was in this full focus doing this test.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? Why is data class not compiling? The tool is buggy. I'm not even questioning myself. I don't know why.
Yeah.
And then I saw those terminal operators everywhere. I was like, oh, no.
Yeah.
It's in Java. And then it took me so much effort to tell myself, now I need to do get to retrieve a value. I need to end my code line with a terminal operator. And it took me so much brain power to do the switch in an test situation.
Yeah,
it was
that's hilarious.
Really confusing.
And that's also my experience, for instance, with streams and a lot of data transformations.
Exactly.
In Java, this stuff is hard and it's just really only accidental complexity. It's just of no use. It's just complex for nothing. Yeah. And that's also my experience. I find in this regard, or in these cases, I find Java even a really complex language in that sense. Also, when you do a bit of higher order functions and you have these function interfaces, figure out the right interface, especially with the numeric types and the like, it's just a hell. Make things very complex. When Kotlin, you just throw it on your IDE and it works.
Yeah, man, that sounds funny. I don't have the same Java background as you did. And I've started with Kotlin, but that was kind of a new project in that way. I don't have the same experience, but it's pretty funny to hear that when you do actually go back, it's with some kind of pain.
Yes.
And not just you or you feel it, but a lot of your peers as well.
Exactly. Yes. It feels really awkward.
Yeah. Very old school experience.
Yeah.
Sounds like it, like you're taking a step back in that way as well.
Exactly.
And also with the newer Java feature, because I closely look at the Java ecosystem. I haven't just put it aside because I think you need to be aware of it. Maybe they make a bold move. You never know.
Yeah.
With Loom, for instance, that's probably something interesting and so on. So I keep it closely, I watch it closely. But till now,
it's not there yet.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Man, I'm thinking about, let's say, still I'm going to keep the same example because it's the most relevant one I have, but you're in a team and already within a Java project. I think something needs to prime you to start trying out Kotlin, right? And I think it can be within the development team. Can it also come from kind of an organizational requirement or even kind of question, I guess? What have you guys seen? Has it always flowed throughout the team and then gone to the organization to kind of convince them this is the way to go? Yeah. Or has it also started by organizations saying, no, 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 we should try Kotlin now, and then it flows to the development teams?
I haven't experienced the second one.
Yeah. Exactly. So it was quite interesting. Indeed, the ignition always came from developers, and I also just looked at the Kotlin side about statistics, and it's about 70% plus comes from developers who want to use Kotlin. So they see these tool helps me to write better code, and then from bottom up, management facilitated because anyway, don't understand it, and the developer says it's okay, and then let's do it. That's often the way it goes. So it's really a bottom-up movement, Kotlin, in that sense. And I think that's a good thing because the people who are using it make the decision to use it. I think that's the right responsibility at the right place.
Yeah. Exactly. I really like that. That's how it should be within a language that you need, right? It should fit the thing that you're doing, right? And even moving from Java to Kotlin, it's already kind of covering the base that you're doing it, right? Otherwise, you wouldn't have a Java project. And if it's easy to transition to Kotlin with gaining those same benefits that you guys have laid out, then why not, right? Start experimenting, start trying out, and gain those benefits and benefit from that, basically. Yeah. But if an organization wants more help, let's say they have multiple teams on Java projects and they're like, well, we did a proof of concept within a team and we really realize the benefits, right? Reduction in code increases clarity. Also with pull requests, it's just faster because it's less boilerplate, basically. Yeah. And they want their teams to set up Kotlin, basically, in a more organizational structure. Are there any trainings that they can basically request or any places they can go to get that knowledge up par?
Yeah, there are lots of companies. We both
offer training.
We both offer training, so we don't want to do any marketing tricks, I think. Yeah. But I started with the Kotlin cones in IntelliJ. Those are just some small exercises to get the... to know the language and its features.
Yeah.
In the educational plugin of IntelliJ, so that's pretty good. Mm. IntelliJ also tries to gather the training programs that are developed everywhere, so you can also consult their website in that regard.
They do a great job. That's correct.
Yeah, they do a great job. So you can just go to JetBrains on that part, or just start looking to people that offer those trainings.
Exactly, that's a small plug, right? Yeah, that's quite funny, actually. How long have you guys been training in Kotlin?
I've given those workshops since 2018, I think, on conferences.
Yours?
4 years by now.
4 years by now.
So more or less also 2017-18 I started with it.
Is there still like a language feature that's missing, or are things they're still working on or kind of discussing, and do we need to introduce this or do we leave it as is?
It's quite interesting because when you look at all the major, actually minor versions of Kotlin, 1.3, 4, 5, 6, there have almost no new features been introduced that are really kind of extremely relevant.
Yeah.
They had some minor additions like value clauses, like you can... keep the comma when you have a multi. It's just all kind of very minor things. So my impression is that the first edition of Kotlin, or all the features they introduced there, they were just right. And they were also some sort of complete. And now they're just at the edges, they scratch and make things a bit more user-friendly. They also, what I've heard is they will want to introduce things like metaprogramming, more kind of compiler APIs. These kind of additions, which are not really core to the language, but the language itself, it's kind of, it was first time right.
I think it's true. They're just smoothing it up a bit. They removed the Kotlin nullpoint exception, finally.
Yeah.
So you get those old school nullpoint exceptions, stuff like that. But those are not the big changes.
Yeah.
So I'm really, really curious what will happen if they release once the Kotlin 2.0.
Yeah.
Because, what will be a major release in Kotlin?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a good one. So from a developer perspective, I can only see benefits, basically, probably because I have you two in front of me and not a just singular Java advocate, basically. But from an organization point of view, I can imagine there's a question like, okay, has it been battle tested, right? Is it production ready? And I think it is. But what would you say to a person that still has kind of doubts in kind of embracing Kotlin within their organization?
Google is using it. Yeah. And most of the time, that's the big argument that everyone start doing it.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
It's even advising it, right, to use
yeah,
it.
It's Google even for advising Android, at least. It's an Android official support language.
Yeah.
As of 2017 already. So I guess if they haven't withdrawn that decision, it's production ready, at least for mobile development.
Yeah.
And then IntelliJ has been built entirely, I think, in Kotlin.
Yeah.
Which is doing pretty well.
Pretty well. I'm using it.
I'm using it. And
yeah.
I won't stop using it. So I guess those are already two successful projects that everyone, or two successful decisions.
Yeah, there are so many companies that really have built their whole ecosystem on Kotlin. So also my experience, I started out with 1.3, I guess, 1.2, 1.3. And that's what you also mentioned. Kotlin released very frequently. Minor compile improvement, I guess, because I never had that. All of a sudden, I had the new language or something didn't work anymore. And I never, ever had a single problem with Kotlin. Maybe the very first time there was incremental compilation, I got a bit strange behavior, but that's not really something of language. It's a compiler feature you can turn off. But that was really the only one. For the rest, it just kept on working flawlessly. So in that sense, there is beyond doubt for me that Kotlin could be a problem for your production system. Really not. It's totally...
I think now Spring is supporting stable. It more and more.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And
yeah.
Spring being the major application framework in the industry, it speaks by itself, right? If it wouldn't be production ready, Spring won't be supporting it anyway. So I think that's a very big...
That's good that you mention it, because I think there's another extremely strong reason why Kotlin is so easily adoptable, because it actually allows you to only learn a new language, but keep your existing framework.
Exactly.
I had this Scala journey, and there you have Scala and Akka, and this is really a total different stack and extremely complex, with extremely complex paradigms, like event sourcing, CQRS, with these actor models and so on. This is just a tremendous universe you step into. Whereas in Kotlin, you keep all your Spring objects, you know, all this auto-writing in Spring, good luck if you have to learn it from scratch. It's quite nice if you can keep this investment and only learn this language.
Yeah.
So also, this is a very strong reason that you can stay within your well-known familiar paradigm and only you use a language that makes all the benefits we talked about. And we haven't really talked about coroutines, but I think we also should at least 5 minutes talk about it, because this is mind-blowing, right?
Yeah.
I think so.
How would you explain that in a nutshell? What is a coroutine?
It's a coroutine. Well, it's almost a thread, but it's not a thread.
It's a lightweight thread, right?
It's a lightweight thread. You can run hundreds of them on one single thread. So that's...
It's about 2.4 million per gigabyte, where threads you can run about 4,000 per gigabyte. So it's really an order of altitude, which is beyond your imagination.
And it's something that's inherent within the language, right? You can use out of the box.
The main benefit of Kotlin, if I would put it straight, is that you have these reactive toolkits, which all force you to use their abstraction with a lot of flat mapping. So the abstraction user is extremely complex. It's not... doesn't support the normal language construct like try, catch, and so on. So you have all these kind of operators. And one toolkit is completely from the other toolkit.
Yeah.
So you get a lot of benefit because you don't have this, you have this non-blocking IO and a bit of parallelism. That's what you get. But you pay an enormous price just of the complexity introduced by such a toolkit. And you also sell your soul to this particular toolkit, literally. Because once you've done it, it's everywhere in the code base. Your whole code base will be polluted with it. And actually, coroutine is... solve this problem on the language level, not on the library level. So with coroutines, you actually write the same method signatures like before, except that you use this suspend keyword. But for the rest, in terms of signature, there is no additional abstraction involved. But you get all the benefits of non-blocking, of parallelism, and so on. And that they solved it like that, I think, was also... I don't know for sure, but I think Loom was also partially inspired by these kind of developments. Okay. That they saw, hey, you could solve these things on the language level. Maybe that's my take. Maybe you want to add something to it.
No, I think I completely agree with that. And what you see is that a lot of Kotlin frameworks are also using those coroutines more and more, which means that it's finally getting widely adopted. And that's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think that's the main feature where Kotlin can distinguish itself, at least at the back end.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Android development apart, if you're looking at the back end, coroutines are a high gain.
Yeah,
high gain.
Yeah,
nice.
Yeah.
And also in Android, by the way, because also all these many tasks you can spin up in an app, which you normally would do right in the backend, I guess. Backend is non-blocking is very important, but on the Android you have a lot of asynchronous tasks simultaneously. Yeah. Also there, it's coroutine shine.
Yeah. You guys have any experience with Android development and Kotlin in particular?
Not on enterprise level.
Yeah, to be honest, no. I've looked at KMM, so that's the Kotlin multi-platform mobile. Yeah. They are trying to push. I've done some experience with it because it's production ready officially, but they're really still working hard on it.
And
I've seen the benefits of it.
Cool.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Awesome. Any final thoughts? Any things that are left on the table, you think? Or did that kind of cover most of it?
We covered a lot already.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
That's how it goes.
Yeah, I think not only Kotlin is kicking Java's butt, but the Kotlin ecosystem is also kicking the butt to the Java ecosystem. I mentioned Spring.
Yeah.
But if you see that there are also other application frameworks popping up, I don't know if they will make it through the end, but the concepts that they're introducing also have some influence on Spring implementation, I guess. So I really like that the community is finally empowered to see what they want to see in the coding libraries, frameworks, languages. And that's what Kotlin is introducing as well. So it's cool.
Yeah, probably makes it feel awesome to be part of that community as well then.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, I think that's a big benefit as well.
Yeah.
Cool. Urs, any final thoughts?
Yeah, I think what you see is that probably Kotlin started out more as a language, and now you see that there is really much more around it. So also tooling, especially because it's a tool maker makes a language, it can deliver an awesome tooling experience, but not only with IntelliJ itself, but also with the multi-mobile of Kotlin multi-mobile platform. They allow you to embrace much more than a language, but also way more things around it that you can write applications not only on the backend and Android, but also desktop applications and so on. So Kotlin is redeveloped itself not as a language, but as a whole ecosystem to create all kind of applications, which is actually really possible by another language in a sense that they don't own such a tool chain as rich as the one that JetBrains offers. So in that sense, I think the future is quite bright with Kotlin in that sense. And my impression is it just got started.
Awesome. Cool. Thank you guys so much for coming on. I really love the passion that you guys have when kind of explaining these topics. I really felt it. So thanks for coming on. And we'll do this again sometime.
Sure.
Cool. Urs and Paulien, everyone.
From your sponsors, Zebia, creating digital leaders.